glad you're here. We've come to worship the Lord. Hey, good church this morning. Come back for a fresh blessing tonight. And we sure are looking forward to that. Lord bless each one of you. Hey, we want to begin the service in prayer. Pray the Lord bless our worship this evening. It be acceptable to Him. Brother Jim Sutton, would you begin our service in prayer? Thank you, Lord. Amen. 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 All right, just a couple announcements and a few, and we'll get right into the service. General board meeting right after the service this evening. Wednesday worship, 7 o'clock. Brother Rich is up this Wednesday evening. Looking forward to that. Friday is the Ladies of Grace luncheon. That's in the fellowship hall at noon. There's a list inside the newsletter that tells who's bringing food. So if you're not on that list, boy, you get to come and eat without bringing anything. So anyway, it's going to be a good time. And then Saturday, men's breakfast, 8 o'clock Saturday morning. And that's always a good time of fellowship and always a good breakfast. And so we're sure looking forward to that also. Brother Larry, are you bringing the devotion for that? I'm trying to recall. The devotion Saturday morning, is that up to you? Okay, I thought it was around to you. And so Brother Larry will be bringing the devotion that morning. Okay, several on the prayer list. A lot of folks need the Lord's touch. Just heard Sister Margie Hefner. She's been in the emergency room. They are admitting her. So she's been real sick today. So hold Margie up in prayer. Again, remember the Hudson family in bereavement. Visitation Tuesday night for Vera. Wednesday funeral. And just hold all them up in prayer this evening. All right. God bless you. Good to see you tonight. Let's stand while we sing.
It's going to be page 514.
I want to be a worker for the Lord. I want to love and trust His holy word. I want to sing and pray, be busy every day in the vineyard of the Lord. I will work, I will pray in the vineyard of the Lord. I will work, I will pray, I will labor every day in the vineyard of the Lord. I want to be a worker every day. I want to lead the erring in the way that leads to heaven above, where all is peace and love in the vineyard of the Lord. I will work, I will pray in the vineyard of the Lord. I will work, I will pray, I will labor every day in the vineyard of the Lord. I want to be a worker strong and brave. I want to trust in Jesus' power to save. All who will truly come shall find a happy home in the vineyard of the Lord. I will work, I will pray in the vineyard of the Lord. I will work, I will pray, I will labor every day in the vineyard of the Lord. I want to be a worker, help me, Lord, to lead the lost and erring to thy word that points the joys on high, where pleasures never die, in the vineyard of the Lord. I will work, I will pray, in the vineyard of the Lord. I will work, I will pray, I will labor every day in the vineyard of the Lord.
Brother Jim, I think it's in prayer.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this day.
Amen.
King, be seated.
264, Kneel at the Cross. Kneel at the cross, Christ will meet you there. Come while he waits for you. List to his voice, leave with him your care, and begin life anew. Kneel at the cross, leave every care. Kneel at the cross, Jesus will meet you there. Kneel at the cross, there is room for all who would his glory share. Bliss there awaits, harm can ne'er befall those who are anchored there. Kneel at the cross, leave every care. Kneel at the cross, Jesus will meet you there. Kneel at the cross, give your idols up, look unto realms above. Turn not away to life's sparkling cup, trust only in his love. Kneel at the cross, every care. Kneel at the cross, Jesus will meet you there. And the last one will be 463. I am thine, O Lord. I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me near, near, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me near, dear blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Oh, the pure delight of a single hour that before thy throne I spend. When I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. Draw me near, near, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea. There are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me near, near, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me near, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side.
All right, we'll receive our evening offering. Give to the Lord as we love him this evening. Brother Rick, would you lead us in prayer? Yes, Lord. Amen. Amen.
This goes along with Brother Larry's message this morning, so eternity is a long time. Track two. Sorry.
When the melody's been written, eternity has changed. this world and all its pleasure will soon be passed away. The final invitation could be going out today. You're standing at the crossroads, Savior's calling you. This life has many choices, eternity has too. The straight and narrow way leads to life, the broad way down below. What would it profit to gain the world and lose your very soul? Tomorrow is uncertain. Our days on earth are few. This life has many choices, eternity has two. This life has many choices, eternity has two.
Go ahead, Brother Matt. Standing in heaven with tears in his eyes, saying, tell me this isn't so. For there was no one in heaven and no one on earth worthy to open the scroll. Then one of the elders said, John, don't you cry, it was all part of his plan. Then in the center of God's glorious throne, hallelujah, there stood a lamb. And they sang, worthy, worthy of honor and praise. They were casting down crowns and praising his name. When he cried, who is worthy, I could hear Jesus saying, I am. Oh, praise God forever. There stood a lamb. Now open your Bibles and open your hearts. It's clear we are in the last days. And he said, I'll come quickly. So don't be surprised when he comes back to take us away. And feeble excuses won't get very far when you find yourself there at his throne. If you know Jesus and he is your Lord, hallelujah, you won't be alone. And we'll sing, worthy, worthy of honor and praise. We'll be casting down crowns and praising his name. Praising his name. When he says, are you worthy? I can hear Jesus saying, I am. Oh, praise God forever. Praise God forever. Praise God forever. There stood a lamb.
One of these days, we're going to cross over.
Amen.
There's a river somewhere that's called Jordan, and they say that it's deep and it's wide. And they say that the king and the beggar on that shore will stand side by side at the crossing of the Jordan. Why should I be afraid? There'll be someone who loves me to guide me across that river to endless joys above. Though that river is dark and stormy, it will pass like a dream in the night, and my soul will awake in the morning in regions of endless delight at the crossing
of the Jordan. Why should I be afraid? There'll be someone there who loves me to guide me across that river to endless joys above.
The book of Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. Hey, good church this morning. And looking forward to this evening's service. Wednesday night, we preached a message on the great need to be personally grounded and rooted in the Lord Jesus Christ. There is so much deceiving going on in these last days. False teaching, false doctrines. The devil's days are numbered, and he's throwing everything he can at the church. And so I think we're all under attack this evening, from the pastor to the back door. But listen, so Wednesday night we looked at the importance of being grounded personally. Tonight we're going to just go a little step further and think of it more collectively, the church. Okay? Who makes up the church? Well, all of us. And if we're all personally grounded, then the church ought to be grounded, right? But we're going to look at that tonight, the rooted church, grounded in the Lord. Stand with me, you would like to, as we read just the first verse. Colossians chapter 1, verse 1. Actually, I'm going to read the first 9 verses. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ that are at Colossae. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which you have to all the saints. For the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which is come unto you as it is in all the world and bringeth forth fruit, as it doth also in you since the day you heard of it and knew the grace of God in truth. As you also learned of Ephraim, I have a hard time with that one, our dear fellow servant, who is for you a faithful minister of Christ, who also declared unto us your love in the Spirit. Finally, verse 9, for this cause we also, since the day you heard of it, do not cease to pray for you, to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Have prayer with me. Father, we come to you again tonight in the name of Jesus, still thanking you for your blessings and your presence upon this morning service. But Lord, how we thank you tonight for the many that are here. Lord, we're very mindful of so many need your touch tonight. We had such a long prayer list. And Lord, we bring all these petitions and requests, Lord, of our brothers and sisters before you tonight, meet their needs. And Lord, we just pray right now, fill us with your Holy Spirit. We can't do anything without you, so bless the preaching of your word tonight. Encourage and strengthen this church body, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. This is a letter from the Apostle Paul to the church at Colossae. You know, and here's the 2 verses we looked at Wednesday night. Look at chapter 2, verse 6 and 7. It says, as ye have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. Now, if I was going to define what Paul meant in that verse, it's simply this. Hey, if you say you're saved, walk like it. Act like it, right? Hey, you that have received Christ, walk in him. And then finally in verse 7, he said, rooted and built up. Hey, our roots ought to go deep in Jesus tonight. And built up in him, established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. But we're thinking tonight of the church that's been grounded and rooted in the Lord Jesus Christ. And why shouldn't it be? It's his church. He bought it. He paid for it. He owns it. Amen. The church is his, blood bought.
by the Son of God. And so we owe him all tonight. And so we are established. Paul's talking about ministry here in this verse. Paul is going to set the record straight in some of these verses. The man visited Paul in a Roman prison, told him there was some problems back at Colossae, the Colossian church. In fact, he told him that even though it was about 1,000 miles from Rome, he was saying, you know, there's some issues going on back there. And what was the problems in the church of Colossae? Some of the believers were being uprooted. There was some false teaching creeping in, some demonic powers and spirits that was influencing within the church family. And what is the outcome of that? Some folks was being uprooted, okay? They was falling away from the Lord. And by the way, that's still one of the battles of the church today, I think. The devil's still trying to uproot folks.
Right.
Still trying to get you away from being grounded in the Word of God and the will of God. And whatever the devil can use to get you pulled up and get you out, he will absolutely try and attempt to do that this evening. One of the big problems they had back there at the church at Colossae was the doctrine of the deity of Christ. Many of them was denouncing that. Many of them was rejecting that teaching that Christ Jesus himself was God in the flesh. Okay? They was denying a holy trinity of the Father and the Son of the Holy Ghost. And so Paul is being warned about this. That's what brought him to some of the things that he said over in chapter 2. I read to you verse 6 and 7. Let me add to that verse 8 and 9. Chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. False teaching. After the tradition of man. After the rudiments of the world. And not after Christ. We ought not follow anybody but Jesus.
Amen.
We ought not listen to any doctrine out there, lest it be the doctrine of Christ Jesus our Lord. For verse 9, Paul said, "For in him, in Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily." And so Paul faces the issue. He approaches it, and he's very clear. There is the deity of Christ, isn't there? Absolutely. So what do we see here? You know what? As believers, we must be rooted in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And as we covered last Wednesday night, the best way to do that is, of course, through your prayer life. It needs to be daily. Through your meditation time, through the Word of God, through times of private worship, as well as times of public worship. And that's how we get rooted deep in the Lord Jesus Christ. In our church, as a church body, we need to be rooted in Christ this evening. The wonderful relationships we share as a church body. I put something in our newsletter today. God has blessed us with an awesome church family, hasn't he? He really, really has. I mean, we are so blessed here at Gospel Light. The relationships we have, and our relationships are all connected through God's grace, through God's favor. Our relationships are all connected. It's all part of God's sovereign plan. The relationship between pastor and the congregation, God ordains that. God blesses that. God uses that. I mean, I'm here as your pastor. You are here as the congregation. And what do? We worship together. We pray together. We sing together. We have church together. Listen, it's all ordained of God. I've said this so many times. I'm going to tell you something. Church was God's idea. It wasn't some idea men come up with. Well, it'd be a good thing to gather together. No, it was God's idea. And we do it in obedience. We do it in faithfulness tonight. It's God's idea. So Paul said it was divinely appointed by God, by the will of God. We began with chapter 1, verse 1. Look at that verse again. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the what? By the will of God. And of Timotheus, our brother, by the will of God, approved by God, appointed by God, by the will of God. And these relationships, you know, they're all observed by God tonight. All we Everything we do in the church is seen by God. That's the absolute truth. If we're growing in our faith, that's, God sees that. If we're tending to get cold and indifferent and lukewarm and backsliding, God sees that too. He absolutely does. He knows our faithfulness. He knows if we're being uprooted. And so God refers to the faithful in verse 2. In fact, he calls the saints and faithful brethren. Look at verse 2. To the saints, who's it to? To the saints and faithful brethren in Christ, which are at Colossae, the Colossian believers. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Who's the letter to? It's to the saints. That simply means the saved. Okay? I heard somebody say several years ago, you're either a saint or you ain't. Right? Hey, you're either saved or you're lost. You either know Jesus or you've rejected him. And so he's talking about, when I said God knows the church, he calls them the faithful brethren. He knew their faithfulness. He knew those that were grounded truly, those that were steadfast in their faith, and those that had done well in their walk with God. Positionally tonight, if we are saved, we're considered a saint according to Scripture. We know we're not sinless by any means. We still deal with the flesh. We still fight sin every day. We still need to pray a prayer of forgiveness from time to time, don't we? But I tell you what, it's not good to know that positionally we are now the saints of God, the redeemed, the saved by grace. And Scripture says in the Old Testament, let the redeemed say so, right? So the church, you know what? We cannot declare that you're saved, and you're saved. No, the Holy Spirit does that. Amen. The Holy Spirit declares if you've obeyed the Lord and you've repented, you've accepted Christ, that you know what? The Holy Spirit declares us saved by the amazing grace of God. I'm not going to go and read those scriptures, but there's the seven letters of Revelation. In Revelation chapter 2, chapter 3, they are literal letters written to churches, and every single one of those seven letters, Jesus said to the church, I know thy works. I know thy works. He knows all about us. He knows every move we make. He knows every decision we make. He knows what we discuss, what we are concerned about. He knows what we have compassion for. Listen, the Lord knows us tonight. And that ought to cause us to just get a little rooted deeper, right? Absolutely. It's a great thing to know tonight that God knows the Gospelite church. And when I say that God knows the Gospelite family, I can take that just a step further. God knows every one of you by name. Knows the hairs on your head, right? He knows us personally that make up the church body this evening. And so we're connected by grace. Aren't you thankful for grace? Amen. Praise the Lord. It was grace that got us saved, the favor of God, as we demonstrated our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then we see the resilience of that grace. You know, the very reason we continue on faithfully, we wasn't just saved by grace. Listen, church, we are continuing on as a church by God's favor and grace. Okay? I think we have such great services at Gospel Light. Not because of the preaching, not because of the specials, not because of good congregationals. I just believe when we come into this place with a right attitude and a right spirit, we're hungry for worship, we're loving Jesus with all of our heart, I believe God shows up. Amen. And then he does bless the singing and the preaching and everything else we do. Listen, that's all part of the favor of God. So we didn't just all get saved and we're just kind of hanging around now. No, listen, we got saved and by God's grace, we're going to continue on until the day we cross over, to the day he calls us home, okay? And you know what he does by his grace as we continue on? He supplies strength and everything we need to get us from here to there. We go through struggles. We go through problems. We go through things we personally deal with. And every now and then, maybe something the church has to deal with. But listen to me. It's his grace that will give us the strength to make it through unto the very end. With Paul, you know, in all of Paul's 13 letters to believers, he opens with these words, grace be to you. Paul knew the importance of God's grace, which really is the unmerited favor of God, isn't it? He prayed for each church that God's grace would be upon them. God's grace. Go in God's grace. You know, and we find in the scripture, you know, it's God's grace that supplies strength to the church. There's a scripture we're all familiar with it probably, but it's found back, just a little bit, in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 9, Paul is dealing with some things. He prays three times that God will remove it. And I like the answer that he gives in verse 9. We see what Jesus has to say. And he said unto me, let's just start verse 7 so we see what's coming down. He said, lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations that was given to me as a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. Now there's only one way we can interpret that. Paul had a real problem that was really a hindrance to him, and he prays three times for the Lord to remove it. Now if anybody had power in prayer, would you agree Paul did? I would almost think if Paul was to pray one prayer, God was right there to answer it right now. And that happened many, many times. But in this instance, he prays a second time, and there's still no answer. And he prays a third time, and there still seems to be no answer. But listen, by him getting no answer was the answer. By him not receiving the strength that he prayed for, he realized he couldn't do it with his strength, and the Lord, it made Paul trust the Lord more. It made him trust him more. You know, we can kind of relate to that, all of us probably. If everything's just lovely and no problems, carefree, every day is such a wonderful day, never have it, you know, you in that daily time frame of blessings, you could almost get to the point you didn't need God too much. Things is going pretty good for you and yourself and I, right? But when problems come, we drop to our knees in prayer. We become more dependent on Christ than we are on ourselves. And when we become more dependent on Him than we are on us, do you realize that gives us strength? That's what Paul found out. That's what happened. So the strength that Paul receives, it was the Lord's way of giving him strength by making him more dependent on Christ. And that's what brought Jesus to say these words in verse 9. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9. He said to Paul, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Now, I read that and said that because sometimes I think that's how we get more strength in our lives, even as a church. Listen, the Lord has a supply of strength available for us through His sustaining and amazing grace, but we receive it more abundantly when we trust Him more. Oh, when we depend, hey, the better we can get rooted, the better we're going to get in on this grace thing, right? And so we look at the wonderful grace of God. There is a resilience in the church because of that growing in grace. God gives us grace in times of suffering. God gives us grace in times when we're serving. And God gives us grace when we're growing. But as we found too many times this year already, it seems God has even given grace when it comes time to die. Isn't God wonderful? Amen. His amazing grace, His sustaining grace. So what we're dealing with here is it's been ordained by God Himself. God knows who is faithful. And it's in His grace that He strengthens us, He sustains us in our service. And I like what Jesus told Paul, that His grace was sufficient. What that simply means, it's enough. You don't need God's grace in something else. God's grace is enough to see us through and to bless us and to give us strength. Oh, listen. So he gives us strength for all these things. You know, you can fill up the gas tank, but as much as I drive, I've got to keep stopping and put more gas in it. That's the absolute truth. And you know what? You can put some money in the bank, and if you use your debit card enough, you will have to put some more money in the bank. And we can get rooted in Christ tonight and praise the Lord, grounded in him real good. But I tell you what, we still need more and more and more of him. We don't want to run short, do we? He's sufficient. His grace is sufficient. Praise the Lord. There is that resource from God that is sufficient. My grace is sufficient for thee. Now back to our text, Colossians 1, verse 3. We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. We're talking about the remembrance of the church. Not only did God remember their relationships, hey, Paul remembered them also. I mean, even though he had never met some of these folks, he had a love for them because they was the church. Paul felt that kinship with them. We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. Praying always for you. Listen, we ought to always be praying for one another. Amen. There's much we ought to be praying about this evening. Paul speaks boldly about the relationship of God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And you know, being rooted in the Lord ought to bring us to the place of prayer. Listen, so he's really accomplishing what he set out to do. He's setting things straight on the deity of Christ. He absolutely is. Hey, Christ Jesus, God in the flesh. Amen?
Amen.
Listen, there's a lot of versions of the Bible tonight, but I personally still love and cling to the King James Version. Listen, because it defends the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. Some of the new versions, by the way, do not. So, verse 3, praying always for you. That sounds like continual praying. That sounds like being mindful on a pretty regular basis to pray for the church. How many times a day do you pray for lost loved ones? How many times a day do you pray for your spouse or for your children, for your church family? How many times a day do you pray for revival because you know he sure needs it? How about pray for your pastor? Listen, Paul remembers to pray for them always. But something happened. I think the more they prayed for one another, the more rooted they became. The more grounded in Christ they became. I believe it. Look at verse 4. Since we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which you have to all the saints. And that's one thing there seems to be a real abundance of at Gospel Light tonight. It's good to know you folks love each other.
Amen.
Okay? It's good to know we love the Lord, we love each other, and we do love lost souls that we want to see them get saved. Oh, listen, Paul heard that they were saved, he heard that they was loving, and he's reminded to pray for them because of that very thing. It was, I think, with a holy excitement that brought Paul to pray for this church. They had a love for each other, for the church family, and for the work of God. And then you know what? He gives us verse 5, and I'm just about done. For the hope which is laid up for you in heaven. Church family, do you know there's a hope laid up for us in heaven tonight? Hey, praise the Lord. There's something better on the other side. And he says that hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof you heard before in the word, the truth of the gospel. The reason I have such hope in heaven tonight is not only because Jesus died for sinners, but because he died for me and I'm saved. That gives me hope. Just knowing Christ died for sinners, That's good to know, and that's knowledge, and that's understanding for some folks, but you got to make it personal. He saved me.
Yes.
That gives me hope. Where? In heaven. In heaven. That's what Paul described there. Here's the scripture in closing found over in the book of 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 and 4. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 and 4. Peter said this, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." A living hope, right? But notice verse 4, "to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that fadeth not away." Praise the Lord. Well, this is good. You ready for the end of that verse? "Reserved in heaven for you."
Amen.
I got reservations in heaven tonight. Don't know when. I don't know the due date. I don't know when I'm going. You know, you may make reservations for a trip like some of you just did. You tell them the night you're going to be there and when you're coming. And you know what? And when you get there, usually your room's waiting on you.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I got a room waiting on me in heaven.
Amen.
And I can't tell the Lord when I'm coming because he's the only one that knows. But it's been reserved in heaven for me. So I got a living hope. Amen?
Amen?
My hope is in Christ and nothing else. So it is when we put our faith in Christ, now we have hope in heaven tonight. Oh, his grace. Praise the Lord. Saving grace, sustaining grace, strengthening grace. The only thing that really matters tonight is our faith in Christ. Our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So what have we seen between Wednesday night and tonight? First of all, we need to personally, make it personal, be saved and rooted and grounded in Jesus and in the Word of God. And what we have added to that tonight is secondarily and yet connected as a church, as a local body of believers. We also need to be rooted in Christ. Church, it's all about him.
Amen.
It's all about him. And so we love him and we praise him and we serve him and we thank him.
Yes.
Praise the Lord for his amazing, amazing grace. God bless you tonight. When the devil tries to pull you up by the roots, you take him to the Word of God and show him who's boss. And in much prayer, let him know it's time to hit the road.
Amen.
You're the Lord's.
Yes.
And your reservations are in heaven.
Yes.
God bless you tonight. Let's stand. Let's sing two verses of an invitation. If you need prayer, the altar's open. The altar's always open. It ought to always be open. Time for you to get with God. Father, we thank you for the great day you've blessed us with here at Gospel Light. Your blessing upon the Word of God, your blessing upon the preaching and the singing, and Lord, the spirit of worship. We thank you for this place and how you've blessed us. Lord, tonight, thank you for your grace, saving grace, sustaining grace. Lord, strengthening grace. And tonight, we just want to be ever more grounded and rooted in the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, you know us by name. And we that are saved, it's so exciting tonight to know we've got reservations in heaven. Bless now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Any prayer, you just come on. Last verse.
Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blood to thee, whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come.
And everybody said amen. God bless you. It's been a good day in the Lord's house. General board meeting right after church. I don't think we'll be too long, but listen, it's been a wonderful day with God's blessing upon us. Let's sing our song.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know and life is worth the living just because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Everybody said, praise the Lord.